In this video, I will attempt to make the world generator for my C++ multiplayer Minecraft clone get as good as the original or even surpass it. To do this, we'll dig into how they did it and try to replicate it, adding my own generator rules to their approach, because they really had some big brain ideas, as you'll soon see. I even added a custom hidden village, and I almost even made a mini programming language doing this, so stick around because you don't want to miss what's coming. So, if I were to change a single thing about Minecraft, it would be the world generation. Don't get me wrong, Minecraft did a very good job with their world generation, and after the Caves and Cliffs update, they even improved their caves significantly with better mineshafts and underground forests and lakes, so it will be quite a challenge for me to add all of those features. What I would like to see in Minecraft is more structures and more interesting dungeons to explore, so this is what I will try to add to my clone, and hopefully, in the end, it will end up with more interesting worlds than they have. But I have to start from zero, so let's talk some basics about the world generation. The simplest things that make up a Minecraft world are its shape and biomes. The shape specifies mountains and caves, while the biomes define what kind of forests and features to paint on top of that shape. But how can we generate this programmatically? Well, for a game with a small world like Terraria, we can just generate it in the beginning. For something like Minecraft, which is an extremely big world, we have to generate the world on the go. Imagine there are two chunks. When I approach them, the game will load the closest one and later the next one. Notice that we can't randomly assign its shape to a chunk because they won't align. And since I could also approach them from the other direction, we can simply generate them in a given fixed order. We have to generate a chunk individually. We need a function that, given a chunk position, gives us back a shape, but this shape will always align with the neighboring chunks, without looking at them. For this, PerlinNoise is used. It is a pseudo-random function that generates an image that looks like this. You can assign the white areas to mountains, the black areas to valleys, and the gray ones to plains. You can also use something similar to assign biomes. To generate this image, I decided to use a library called FastNoiseMD that has multiple noise types and it is very well optimized. The simplex version looks very nice and it is also fast, so I rely on it mostly, but also try to use other cheaper noises where possible. I realized, however, that if I went very far, the noise algorithm would break, but that's okay, because I couldn't find a noise library that uses doubles instead of floats to fix this, and also because Minecraft doesn't fix this either. It just limits the player to going only 30 million blocks in one direction, and I think that is good enough. Initially, I tried to make a world generator without looking too much into how Minecraft did it. In my first Minecraft clone, I used the noise map to determine what biome I was in. I had a big list of biomes that would specify not only the block and trees to place, but also the terrain-shaped characteristics. Using this noise map, I wrote the code to automatically pick one of those specified biomes. Using a second noise, I would determine the shape of the map, taking into consideration the specification of the biome. In the borders between biomes, I would blend between the values of the two biome types to not have abrupt changes in height. Looking back at it, this approach worked quite well. It was easy to tweak and add variety to the world. I made, for example, this crazy desert biome. There is an important statistical property of the noise. Its values combined are supposed to average to gray, so that, in theory, would give me an equal distribution of all of the biome types. This didn't seem to work in practice, and I thought that meant that the noise was actually biased to be higher or lower. But in actuality, I was just stupid and didn't read the documentation, but we'll get there later. Let's look now at some tricks that Minecraft uses in their world generation. I will use some footage from this video because it was very nice and informative. So, Minecraft starts with a noise map to determine the world's height, but that doesn't give enough variety. So they have two more additional noises, and they combine all of them. Now this alone doesn't provide very nice terrain either. I wanted to somehow get rid of these ugly rounded mountains that basically give off the vibe of a computer-generated terrain. And here is when I got the first revelation from this video. After they generate the noise map, they apply a spline to it. If you don't understand how this works, I want to make a Maths for Game Development video at some point. But basically, you take the input that is here on the x-axis and look at this graph to see where to remap it on the y-axis. Example time. So this spline continues to leave the input unchanged, while this one sets it to 0 only. This spline squishes the input, and this one reverses it. Finally, this spline removes the middle values. Why is this so powerful? Well, we can create mountains and plains like this. you can see that I made my own noise editing tool using some Inguei code that I found on the web. Our code. And this allows me to easily edit the world settings and save them to later load them in the game. And in this way, I could also have different world generation settings per world. After the shape of the world is generated, air is replaced with water at a certain height. And the top layer of stone is replaced with grass. Looking at the water, you probably noticed that I added transparency since the last video. And I also changed the textures. This is because I work on multiple features in parallel. Multiplayer was also significantly improved, and I am also working on adding lights and nice shaders, so subscribe now to not miss out when those videos come up. Now, to save this world settings data, I could have used the JSON library now that I think about it, but where is the fun in that? Since I basically know how to write a programming language, making a serializing language like JSON was an easy task for me, so I'm not kidding you, this is what first came to my mind, to write my own parser for a custom data saving format. And I'm not talking about that scuffed thing that you quickly throw into your project, no, no. This thing has grammar. It can have white spaces, or it cannot. It can have redundant commands, and it even has sublocks. Now that I've already lost half a day of my life doing this, you'll have to sit and suffer for the next 10 seconds while I explain how it works. But I'll add a Subway Surfers video on the side to keep your attention and the YouTube retention rate high. So the first thing to do was the tokenizer that reads the code and groups it into symbols, and it also throws away the white spaces. Then I made a parser that basically reads the tokens in order and interprets them properly. Like if it sees a seed token, it expects a colon symbol rather than a number, then a semicolon to delimit it from the next character. Phew. Now that I did that and played around with the word settings, I realized that it was, again, biased towards lower values. So to fix this, I did a power component. Raising the input to a power adds a curve to our output, hence biasing them to be higher or lower depending on how we want them. And when I did this, this happened and I realized my mistake. Can you figure it out? The noise actually output numbers between minus 1 and 1, while I always saw that they would be between 0 and 1. Yeah, read your documentation, people. So now with that figured out, I added the other two noises, and for optimization purposes, I wanted to pack as many features into them as possible. So I wanted the first one to create both some lakes and rugged terrain, while the second one to create both oceans and racing terrain. To achieve this, I reused the splines to specify the noise contribution. So for example, the ocean noise is applied last, and it has a very big contribution if its value happens to be low, because that means that you are in an ocean. This terrain looks nice already. However, this is where I had my second revelation moment, and it is the fact that the way they made their world generation was genius. The first noise is the most important, and it generates the oceans and the mountains. This allows them to determine, for example, if they are in an ocean, a plain, a mountain, or a peak. And then, choose a more appropriate biome. And hold tight, the third revelation of this video is coming soon, and it is related to this one. So in the future, I will probably remake it and stick more to how they did it. For now, there is still one problem. I don't have interesting features like this. Well, to achieve this, Minecraft actually uses a 3D noise to generate the terrain, and biases it using the height. So I added that to my editor, and my extremely nice saving system, and started to experiment with it. I also tried making caves with the same noise to save some performance, but gave it up, and I also don't recommend you to do that, because you want to generate your water after this pass, first, and only then add caves to your world. Oh, yeah, how did I forget about the most important part of Minecraft? Caves. Okay, we will get there, but I really got tired of making noises, because, spoiler alert, you also use noise to make your caves. So I started to work at structures, like, you know, trees and villages. So I made an in-game tool that would allow you to save and paste structures. And my plan is to, instead of making them procedurally, just make by hand enough variations to choose from and rotate them whenever they are placed. Now structures come with their own big problems. And it is the fact that they could generate some blocks in non-existing chunks, leading to results like this. You could try to generate that chunk, but that could also create a new tree. Do that again and again until your computer crashes. So the solution is to record those ghost blocks somewhere and add them when you create the new chunk. For bigger structures like villages, this problem is even worse, because if you do this, you could be working, minding your own business, when suddenly you reach the middle of a village and trigger its spawn. I'll show you how I solved that problem when we get there. There are also some problems with multiplayer. Like, what if I add a block to a chunk that was already loaded by another player? And also, isn't it expensive to use that many noises? Well, I'll talk about all these problems in a follow-up video that focuses on multiplayer, but for now, I'll just mention that the server generates the world, and it has its own worker thread for that, so it can communicate with the players who are generating the chunks at the same time. Now, to choose where to plant the trees, I created, you guessed it, yet another noise. And I configured it to have some big forests, and also some small forests. Also, this part has no vegetation at all, and in between the forest and vegetation, there are just patches of grass. And I could make it so each biome has its own spline configuration for this. Oh, speaking of biomes, now if you look at the world, basically I have one biome implemented, so with that in mind, I started to make a generic biome structure. I basically pulled all the data that I used to generate my stuff, like the block types that I used or values, and I also made sure I made it more generic. This will also be saved at some point into the world settings file using my perfect serializing language, but I'll do that another time. I initially added a has water flag so I can remove it in the desert if I want, but then I realized that could lead to results like this. So I just removed it and decided to add the option to choose the water type. So for the desert, you can have sand instead of water. It's not a perfect fix, but it is good enough for now. And now that I had biomes, I had to somehow choose where to place each biome around the world. Well, in Minecraft, they use, you guessed it, two more noise maps, humidity and temperature. Together with the other height maps, they determine the current biome. This allows them, for example, to determine if they are in an ocean or a mountain when choosing the biome type. So as usual, I just configured the temperature and humidity noises similar to how Minecraft does it to start with. You can see that they are configured in steps because, well, we have a fixed number of biomes, and I think that this will also reduce the chance of having strange transitions between biomes. Unlike Minecraft, where they also look at the world shape, I decided for now to use these two noises only for biome choosing because it would be easier to configure and it would add more variety. So you could see a desert mountain, for example. And this is where my third revelation came from. And I really think that this is interesting. So I thought that having all the variety possible would make the world more interesting. But in reality, now you can have anything with an equal chance. All the variety possible is not interesting. But a lot of variety with some rules is. So deserts in Minecraft, for example, are in plains, but have some rare mountains sometimes to break this rule. Having a rule to break makes the world interesting, and the players want to explore it more. But this is why I always say that you learn a lot by doing, so you might improve it later. Okay, for the biome choice, I didn't make a nice editor, nor did I add them to my lovely and perfect serializing language, but I rather sketched some biome ideas on paper, because I love creating things on paper from time to time, and then added them to my game using a hard-coded table. I will show you all the biomes once I finish adding the custom village, because I want them to look as good as possible for the big reveal, and convince you that my clone is better than Minecraft. But I'll mention that I created my own oasis biome that spawns very rarely in the desert, and has some custom cactus flowers and palm trees. Okay, time for villages, but not these boring rounded standard ones. You know what would be cool? To add a hidden jungle village that is high up in the trees and has bridges between its houses. Or so I thought. Yeah, I spent all my days coding on my Minecraft clone, and now I can't even look at a hill without seeing splines and noise maps everywhere. But anyway, let's see how big structures are made. So, my solution is to check if you are close to a big structure, and if so, generate it in advance. This means that 1. I can't make structures infinitely big, because I have to know how far I need to scan until I get to the center of a potential structure to spawn it. And 2. That I have to make the process of finding out if a structure is somewhere fast, because I have to scan out of chunks, and the chunk generation is already taking like 7 milliseconds on average per chunk to generate. So, I divide the world into segments of 32 by 32 chunks, and there can be only one structure inside this area. Maybe one underground and one on the surface in the future, but I would want to not have the possibility of two structures colliding. This also means that a structure can only be 32 chunks, but they will probably all be like 16 chunks max. So next, I use yet again noise, but white noise this time, aka just random numbers, to determine if there can be a structure there, and then I chose where to spawn it inside this area. I have to add this extra step of shifting where to place it, because otherwise, all of the structures would be basically aligned, and we don't want that. Then I just look if I can place a structure there. In my case, I look if I'm in a jungle biome. I created some custom treehouse structures that have some places where bridges can be, and to tell the code where these places are, I created these developer blocks that I can use for more generation flexibility. In this case, I use them to signal where there are bridge joining points. And if I don't end up putting a bridge there, I just replace them with sleeves. I also made two other simple structures just for fun, but before we look at the final result, we still have to talk about caves. So for the caves, you can just use the 3D noise and have a threshold to essentially poke holes into the world after the grass is placed, but before trees are planted. To link the caves, however, there is a trick that you can do. If you look at the noise map, you can see that the grey areas kind of look like a cave system, so keep only those to get what in Minecraft is called spaghetti caves. I still have to find a way to not get this ugly result, but they mostly look nice now. Okay, so this is the result. Starting with the middle biomes, we have plains and forests. I added some color spruce trees and roses for the plains to increase the color palette, and I also did it for the cold biomes by adding some red pine trees. Oh, I also have igloos. There in the desert, depending on the humidity, there is a normal desert and a dry desert. You can also find some small pyramids here, and some are even buried underground. Finally, if you are in the jungle, you might want to look up carefully to not miss the jungle village. A jungle village can have multiple houses that are linked with bridges. Yes, there are improvements to be made, but I'll do them after I improve the multiplayer cold stuff. So subscribe to not miss out that video. Also, if you watched this far, consider sharing the video to help me get to 10,000 subscribers by the end of the year, and maybe check out how I ported this Minecraft clone to Notepad. See you there!